Just a Muslim American sister in niqab, sharing her life's ups and downs with everyday trials and faith in Allah, and well, just living the niqabi life.
أيذكرني وأنساها وليس الحب إلا وهل للقلب من أحد إذا ما الذنب أضناه بصمت الليل يحفظني ويرعاني بعينيه وأدعو وتغرقني عطاياه رحيم ليس يتركني إذا ما قلت أواه قريب لست أدركه ولا تدرك خفاياه وفي سمعي وفي بصري دليل أنه الله أناجيه على خجل وأرجوه وأخشاه وأدعوه ليرحمني فيدركني برحمه لطيف لا يؤاخذنا وإن نحن عصينا قطعناه هو الله هو الله وما للروح إلا هو
surround themselves with the cultural icons of the back home. They watch the back home movies, they listen to the back home music, they follow back home politics, you know, cultural expressions, everything. They want to live in that bubble. They don't speak English. They don't want to speak English. They live here for 40 years, and if you listen to them speak English with an extremely thick accent, you wonder, when did you even arrive to this country? And they want their kids to continue to live in that cultural, you know, background. You know, they don't want to, I'm not even talking about assimilation, I'm talking about reality. I'm talking about understanding who you are and where you live. They want to have nothing to do with their American neighbors. They want to have absolutely nothing to do with non-Muslims. They call everyone that is not Muslim kuffar, and that's it. And they want to live in that bubble. And they want their kids to live in that bubble. And they want their community to live in that bubble. Right? You know what I'm talking about. On the other hand, the other extreme is just as funny. People who live in their postmodern existence, who have achieved financial success, who are, you know, quasi-secular in their lives, they want to constantly rub shoulders with non-Muslims. And their greatest moment of happiness is when they succumb to their inferiority complex and get a word of praise or a pat on the back from the superior white Christian male. They will organize interfaith events, and they will invite the non-Muslims right and left. They will do business with non-Muslims, and they will ignore their own community. There's a lot of interfaith work happening, but no intra-faith work effort whatsoever. Shia is kafir. The Hanbali doesn't know what he's doing. Everyone that is not like me is wrong. But when it comes to the non-Muslims, very open-minded, very open-hearted, let's work together. You see the extremes? Two extremes in our own community. One extreme that is entirely focused inward, and another extreme that is entirely focused outwards. And I say, go back to the Prophet ﷺ and see how he lived it. And see how he balanced his outward with his inward approach. Yes, engage your neighbors. Talk to people. Talk to politicians. Be as American as it can be. But never, never, never forget who you are. You are a Muslim first and foremost. You're an American Muslim, but you are a Muslim. Doesn't matter which country you come from, but you are an American Muslim. And you are Muslim first. And the interests of our community come first. And our masajid and our organizations exist to primarily serve our Muslim community. Yes, we have to do interfaith work. Yes, we have to extend a welcoming arm. Yes, we have to do outreach and PR, but not at the expense of our own people. Not at the expense of our own people. SubhanAllah, the Qur'an, you know, speaks of the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ وَرُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Right? They are strong when they deal with the unbelievers. But between each other, they are humble and compassionate. Our community is often the exact opposite. We are very humble and compassionate with non-Muslims, but we treat our own brothers and sisters very harshly. If a non-Muslim greets you at the mall, smile, good morning, how are you? But if you see a Muslim sister, you don't even say salam to her. And two Muslim sisters, hijabis, they see each other at the mall. What do? Completely ignore each other. Because we have basically become ashidda'u ala al-muslimin wa hama'u ma'a al-kuffar. We have become like this. We are strong with each other and harsh with each other, but we are very, very mellow and nice with the non-Muslims. How about a little bit of balance? Can we be both? Can we be nice with non-Muslims and nice with our own people? Can we have an outward approach of reaching out to everyone else and our neighbors, and we love them and respect them, but also invest in our own people and our own community? Can we do what the Prophet did? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya ala salati, hayya ala al-falah. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
لقد صدق الله رسوله الرؤيا بالحق لتدخلن المسجد الحرام إن شاء الله آمنين محلقين رؤوسكم ومقصرين لا تخافون فعلم ما لم تعلموا فجعل من دون ذلك فتحا قريبا هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا الله
حن قلبي للمدينة لرسول الله فالقلب حنينا طالبا لقيا
يا طيبة الأنوار لي شوق تبعت هدى
يا طيبة الأنوار لي شوق تبعت هدى شوق تبعت هدى
ارتقينا للمعالي والخطى ازدادت حنينا إذ تراءت ك كالخيال روضة الهادي نبينا
التقينا
للمعالي والخطى ازدادت حنينا
اذ
كالخيال روضة الهادي نبينا.
Again, to build their own reality. So for those reasons, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms one simple fact through the Qur'an. That's why this surah is called Al-Furqan, the criterion. Why? Because it is saying all supernatural phenomena, however interesting and cool they might be, the most effective way to establish the existence of God is what? Is the Qur'an itself. The most logically and rational, the most effective way to establish the existence of God is a timeless scripture that bears the spiritual truths that will stand the test of time. And that is basically what the Qur'an is. So let us jump, inshallah, into ayah number 21 and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this section. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَرْجُونَ لِقَاءَنَا لَوْلَا أُنْزِلَ عَلَيْنَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَوْ نَرَى رَبَّنَا. Those who do not believe that they are destined to meet the Lord would say, why have no angels been sent down to us? So now they're basically going to a different level of argumentation. Ya Muhammad, show us miracles. Ya Muhammad, where are the angels? We don't see you surrounded by angels. If you show us angels, you know, we will accept your message and we will follow you right away. Not only that, he say, أَوْ نَرَى رَبَّنَا. How about let us see the Lord? We want to see angels and we want to see the Lord. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us, لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارُ وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارُ. You know, there is no eyesight that can contain Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, let me ask you a question. When we see the angels, that is an indication of what? The moment you see the angels, then what is happening? You're dying. When you see the angels, that means it's too late. So when you desire to see angels, you know, in order for that to be your miracle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically telling you, when you actually get to see the angels, it'll be too late, brother. And you see this, again, in the next ayah number 22, يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَا بُشْرَى يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْمُجْرِمِينَ. The day they see the angels, there will be no good news for them. لَا بُشْرَى. There will be no glad tidings. There will be no good news for them. وَيَقُولُونَ حِجْرًا مَحْجُورًا. And the angels will say, oh, there's going to be this huge obstacle between you and God's mercy. You're not going to see Allah. Not even then. You may see the angels when you die, but you will be denied from seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كَلَّا إِنَّهُمْ عَنْ رَبِّهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. On that day, there will be an obstacle, a barrier, hijab, between them and their Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time I'm driving, the Qur'an is playing. I go home, the Qur'an is playing. And I have to read the Qur'an once a day. I never read the Qur'an. Can someone who reads the Qur'an and listens to the Qur'an every day still abandon the Qur'an? As a matter of fact, that is precisely what we're talking about. We're not talking about those who offer lip service, respect, and reverence to the Qur'an. We're talking about people who may think that they are engaged with the Qur'an, but in reality, they actually abandon the Qur'an, and I will show you how in just a few examples here. So the people of Quraysh, when they abandon the Qur'an as the true miracle, and they continue to wait for amazing supernatural events to happen, they essentially do what? They abandon the Qur'an. That is a form of abandonment, right? In this ayah. And I think that applies to many of us Muslims today who are waiting for spiritual experiences, who are waiting for signs to prove the validity of the Quran, who are waiting for some event to take place to reinforce their faith, when the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is right there. Open it up and read it, and engage it, and ask questions about it, and attend tafsir of it, and figure it out on your own. Right? So that is one way of abandoning the Quran. Second way of abandoning the Quran, when I only read the Qur'an or memorize the Qur'an for the purposes of bringing barakah, just bringing blessing. Do we do that all the time? in Ramadan. Why do we race to recite as much of the Quran as possible? Because we think we will get a lot more rewards if we do that. But let me ask you a question. Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which do you think would make Allah more pleased? So think of this scenario. You have a king, and that king has two subjects. One of them takes the laws of the king and he keeps reading the law. Article number one, article number two, article number three, article number four. While the other subject of the king takes one article, understands it, and he goes and he lives by that article. And then he comes back a couple of days later to tell the king, I'm going to read article number two and I want to live by that article. Which one do you think the king will love more? You see how this is such an issue in our community. Read as much as possible. Quantity, no quality whatsoever. And when I say in Ramadan, just focus on one surah and recite it and memorize it and read the tafsir and understand it and find five lessons and live by them and five bad habits and drop them by the end of Ramadan. And this will be more pleasing to Allah than doing khatam. People get upset when they say, oh, going against the sunnah? What? You're going against the sunnah? The sunnah is to recite as much Riffai as possible. I didn't say go. I just said at least show the king, the Lord, that you are interested in what you need.
لرسول الله فاقتفى القلب